All right. Well, ladies and gentlemen, he is back from a major, major demand from you guys because he mesmerized you, he mesmerized me. So he's back again, Mr. Santos Bonacci, talking about everything astrology. So take it over, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Kapil. Last week we did touch on the two different systems, sidereal and tropical. I thought, what a better occasion than now to clarify the difference and validify both systems rather than criticizing one or the other. Because
instead of vilifying them, showing the positive side of it, I guess.
Yeah. And show how they're valid, because they're just languages. And we're going to show how they are natural languages and how both of them are valid.
Okay.
I do remember the days when I was a Jehovah's Witness that I used to use the argument of precession to prove that tropical astrology is wrong. So for 20 years, I was a Jehovah's Witness, and I used to say, hey, how can tropical astrology be correct when it is out of sync with the stars behind it? So for instance, this is called precession of the equinoxes. What that means is this, that the stars, the constellations themselves, which is the sidereal zodiac, is actually, there's differentiation, there's differential displacement, precession, whatever you want to call it, with regard to the tropical system. So people say, well, then the stars are out of alignment with the tropical position of the planets. Therefore, astrology is wrong, or in particular, tropical astrology. So let's see if we can't clarify that. I do hope that I can, in the short time that we have, even though I will dumb it down for first-time astrologers and beginners who don't really know a lot about astrology or astronomy for that matter, I'm going to try and simplify it, dumb it down, so that I think I can will be able to explain this effectively to both advanced astrologers and beginners. So what we need to understand is that there are two zodiacs. Quite simple. So let me grab my whiteboard. I guess that's the best way to start. So what we have in the heavens is we have a band called the zodiacal belt in the sky. And this is the sidereal zodiac. Sidera in Latin is the same word as astro. It has to do with the fixed stars. The stars that are fixed are the stars that don't move in relation to each other. Whereas the wandering stars, there are seven of them, the sun and the moon, Jupiter, Saturn, Venus, Mercury, Mars. We can see those with our physical eye. And those, they are moving stars, so they move in relation to each other. You know, Mars travels through the zodiac signs as the sun does, but the fixed stars, they never move in relation to each other.
And that's
the fixed stars. So if we get, say, Libra here, and then we get Scorpio, it looks like an S with a little red, beautiful red star in the center called Antares. There are only four red stars in the sky, and one is in Scorpio, and two are opposite in Taurus. and one is in Virgo. So there's four red stars. Mars is red as well. So there are five red objects in the heavens. I just put that there just to make it interesting. So after Sagittarius, Libra, Scorpio, let's put Sagittarius there and let's put Capricorn here. So Sagittarius, Scorpio, Capricorn, and here we have Libra. Now this is the sidereal. This is the sidereal belt. It is 18 degrees wide and 30 degrees long. So every sign is exactly 30 degrees. Now, many astrologers are suggesting that some signs are longer than others.
Yeah, like Virgo. I was going to say that.
Yeah, Virgo is long.
Right.
Aries short. Libra is short. But they're all 30 degrees. They because you see, you don't adjust for the stars that are included in a particular sign. Virgo's stars, for instance, you know, they spread out and go outside of that little box.
Okay.
Virgo is not contained in a 30 degree segment.
Exactly.
Of the sign. It's bigger. So, but this is not how it works. The sky is divided into it's a 360 degree circle. And that circle is segmented into 30-degree segments. So this, as it is correct in that it is 18 degrees wide and 30 degrees long. Now, this is movable. It moves. It's got nothing to do with what I said before about the fixed stars. The stars are fixed in that they don't move in relation to each other. In other words, this star here in Scorpio is always going to be they're never going to separate from each other. There will never be parallax in the constellations of the fixed stars. What I mean by moving is that this zodiac, which is higher up than the sun and the planets, so it's way, way further away, it is moving. It precesses. Precession to precess means to go backwards. So the sidereal zodiac is always struggling and going backwards against the tropical zodiac. What's mm-hmm. the tropical zodiac? Because the tropical zodiac is fixed. Well, it's easy. It's the ecliptic, which runs in the middle. The ecliptic runs in the middle of this 18 degree
okay.
belt. And so these are two zodiacs. And so the sun is always on the ecliptic. The sun can never decline from the ecliptic. Whereas the other planets, the moon and the five wandering stars, they can be positive declination or negative declination. So Mars can be under the ecliptic about here and it can be negative 5 degrees. So, but the sun is always on the ecliptic. The sun rules the ecliptic, and the ecliptic itself never moves. Only the stars move and precess. So there's always going to be a differential between the two systems. It will always be. There will be time when they line up, when Aries on the ecliptic is the same as Aries on the zodiac belt. That happened 2,000 years ago in the age of Aries. And then we came into the age of Pisces, because Pisces has now slipped in to where Aries used to be.
Right.
So the cycle, the cycle of precession is about 25,900 years long. So it's around about 24,000, according to some Indian gurus and teachers.
Yeah.
And then in the West, they bring it up to about 25,920 years. So what happens is the tropical zodiac is always moving against the sidereal zodiac. So it's the war between the two zodiacs. Mm-hmm. Let me explain how this occurs. So let's do it again as I did last week. So last week we saw my graph that I always show, which goes like this.
Right. And
come from? Well, it comes from this. I've shown this many times in my
I've seen that map in your lectures.
Yeah. This is the ecliptic, because this sine wave, and here's March the 21st, the equinox, and you can see the little sign here for Aries, and then up here is Cancer, the Tropic of Cancer.
Mm-hmm.
There's Libra, always in the middle, always balancing. This is the two. It's the seventh sign. It occupies that space there, and it indicates that balance has come in nature, and so does Aries. They are two spiritual signs of balance, and Cancer and Capricorn, they are the feminine signs of material unbalance. Okay, red and blue, like we saw last week. That's what it is. This is the red and the blue. Okay, so now, this never moves. This will never move. In other words, what I'm saying is the equinox is always on March the 21st, no matter where you go. No matter where you go on planet Earth, the 21st of March will always be the equinox. It always has been, and it will never move. So in tropical astrology, we take the constellations to be on the ecliptic. They are on the ecliptic. So Aries will always, 0 degrees Aries will always start on March the 21st. And then April the 21st will be the last degree of Aries and Taurus will begin. Mm-hmm. This will never move because the seasons never move.
Right.
Summer always turns up in Leo, doesn't it? In mm-hmm. India, yep. When Leo comes, It's always in the same area. So the seasons don't shift. Therefore, this tropical zodiac does not move. The sidereal zodiac behind it, further up in the sky, that is precessing slowly, slowly backwards. Every 72 years, 1 degree. So every 72 years.
Yep. Very true.
1 degree.
Yeah.
And so both of them are out of alignment. So your sidereal astrologers, they say, oh, tropical's wrong. And then the tropical astrologers are saying that sidereal is wrong and vice versa. So there's right. this war between the two systems. What they don't understand is these are two languages. There is influence coming from the stars, the fixed stars, the zodiac belt of constellations, and there is a more local tropical zodiac, which is also influencing us. And that is the zodiac that is on the ecliptic. So let's have a look at that with the whiteboard then.
Okay.
And so we learned that on the tropical ecliptic zodiac, which never moves, Aries will always be here. The first sign, 30 degrees. And so we can put all the main tropical points in. We've got Cancer there. Here we've got Libra. And here we've got Capricorn. And so this is a local ecliptic. This is the sun's imaginary line that is trajectory year in, year out. He's always on the ecliptic. And the planets are swimming, traveling on that river. It's like a river, and it is before the constellations, and it works with the constellations.
It is constellation, you mean like nakshatras in Vedic astrology? The 27 lunar mansions. Is that what you mean, or is that something different?
Well, the nakshatras, we have 28 lunar mansions in our tropical astrology. In sidereal astrology, they only consider 27, but it's the same thing. They are exactly the same thing.
Okay.
The moon mansions, it's the moon mansions. The moon has 27, 28 mansions or segments, but they are all inside the zodiac belt of the 12 signs. You see, so for instance, in Aries, there are 2.5 moon mansions. Nakshatras. There are 2.5 nakshatras in Aries, right? Yeah. So the first nakshatra is only 13 degrees, which is...
I like how you pronounce it so perfectly. That is amazing. You're pronouncing better than me, nakshatras. I'm like, wow.
Yeah, well, it's that's a side effect of being a linguist and loving languages. I love languages.
I can see that.
And this is all language.
Yep.
All language. So those nakshatras, they are fixed, and they correspond perfectly with the 12 zodiac signs, because basically the nakshatras are, like, you could say, just a part of the zodiac sign, because they're only, nakshatra is only 13 degrees long. So 13 and 13 make 26, and then there's 4 degrees left over. And so along here, you will also have 28 or 27 in sidereal system. You'll have 28 moon mansions, but you'll only have 12, not 13, 12 sun mansions. But we have to remember, the constellations of the zodiac, those are moving. They're not fixed. They will always precess, okay? Whereas this one is always like this. In other words, on the 21st of March, every year, 0 degrees Aries always begins. Now, the stars behind that, let's put the stars behind. The stars behind, in astronomy, they always start their coordinate system from right ascension of meridian. Right ascension of meridian. That's the same as 0 degrees Aries. But right ascension of meridian is where Aries begins, in 0 degrees Aries. So the zodiac, the sidereal zodiac above the tropical zodiac, it begins at right ascension of meridian in 0 degrees Aries. What is right ascension? Well, right ascension is the lines that go like this in the sky, longitudinal.
Okay.
Latitudinal, that's the declination we were talking about before. Remember we said
that
on the ecliptic, the sun, wherever the sun is on the ecliptic, he never declines. So he can't go south of the ecliptic. He can't go north. He's always on the ecliptic. He is the ruler of the ecliptic. Ra, as we do in Hindu, Sanskrit, and also in Hebrew and Egyptian, it really refers to the sun radiating. Ra, right ascension of meridian. These are the meridians, these lines. So right ascension of meridian always begins at 0 degrees Aries in the constellation of the sidereal zodiac. On the tropical zodiac, it's called 0 degrees Aries. It's not right ascension of meridian. It's two different systems. So really, this is astronomical, you could say, astronomical. This tells you where the seven planets are actually, where they really are physically. So in other words, right now in sidereal, I think the sun is in 2 degrees Scorpio, yeah?
Yes, yep.
Okay, well, today it's in 26 degrees of Scorpio in tropical.
Okay.
So you see there's about a 25 degree lag. Mm-hmm. Sidereal is lagging behind, okay? Because the tropical is fixed.
Yeah.
Sidereal moves. So what does this mean? Does this mean that there is confusion? Does this mean that both systems now are compromised, or that one or the other are compromised? No, it doesn't. And I can show you, I'm going to do a bit of reading for you.
Okay.
And then we'll go back to this, because I always, when I have little time to explain things, I always feel that I don't do it well enough and I need to revisit certain areas. So what I'm going to do is read to you from a book called The Light of Egypt by Thomas H. Burgoyne, Volume 2. I mentioned this in last week's show that we did. I mentioned this book.
Okay, yeah, that's true.
Yeah, and so this one, Volume 2, Volume 1 is also... Volume 1 is also very, very, very good, and it will teach you a lot about syncretism in particular. If you want to be a really good syncretist and be able to fuse and integrate all the sciences, read this book, this one first. But if you want to understand tropical astrology, this is the one to read. And it's very simple. It's very beautiful. Remember that? I showed you that.
Yeah, the Scorpio.
Last week?
Yeah.
Right. Well, that is the zodiac inside the body of the human being.
Yeah, that's so right. Yeah.
I showed you this last week, and I mentioned this book. So what you've got, see, that never changes. Aries is always in the head.
Yep.
Yeah? And Pisces is always in the feet, and we know this. So here's what... Now, you have to bear with me. It's probably about 5 minutes of reading. So okay. I'm going to have to read from a couple of books today. So it might be a little bit boring, but if people
it's knowledge. Absolutely. Go ahead.
Yeah. So if your listeners have got pen and paper, they might want to take down some notes, because otherwise they'll be pinching themselves, because I'm going to be quoting names, a lot of names, and a lot of books today, because what I want to establish is how astrology really, really works today. Natural. It's natural science.
Okay? Absolutely.
So what he's talking about here is his... So what he's talking about in the first chapter is he's talking about this displacement between the sidereal... zodiac and the ecliptic zodiac, which both correspond with each other in that every sign is 30 degrees long, not shorter or longer. So the influence of the 12 signs as described by astrologers, this is what he's saying, this is what people argue. They say the influence of the 12 signs, as described by astrologers, is a delusion, because all the ages, they are reported the same, whereas we know that every 2,160 years, each sign retrogrades to the extent of 30 degrees. And as your art does not make allowance for this, it is false. Okay, this is what the pseudoscientists that believe astrology is a pseudoscience, mm-hmm. This is how they reason. And this is how I reasoned for 20 years when I was a Jehovah's Witness preaching that astrology is from the devil and that it's a pseudoscience because the constellations are out of whack with
right.
The eclipse, you know. So let's continue. For if the influence of the 12 signs does not emanate from the stars occupying the space of those signs, it must emanate from nothing. A doctrine well suited, no doubt, to musty old sages of your superstitious Chaldea, but quite out of court in our progressive age, the last decade of our cultured and scientific 19th century. So far, so good. And so the world rolls along its bright pathway in the heavens, little heeding the logical conclusions of an exact science. But to the initiate of those inner principles of our planet's constitution, all these mental conflicts have a meaning and a purpose within nature's divine economy. For it is neither wise nor expedient that the masses, with popular science in the lead, should grasp the truths which Mother Nature reserves alone for her own devoted priests. So what he's saying is only the devoted priests of this science will ever grasp its language. As for the world who are being led by pseudoscience, well, they're going to miss it. They'll go to their graves, you know, a lot poorer, a lot less wise than they could have been because they missed the true science of everything that is going on. So he continues to say, the shining zodiac with its myriad constellations and a perfect galaxy of starry heavens derives its subtle influence as impressed astrologically upon the human constitution from the solar center of our solar system. So it's saying that the primary influence is the local influence of the ecliptic. That is the primary influence. In other words, he's suggesting that it's more physical, whereas the sidereal would be more spiritual, more transcendental. It transcends. It's higher. It's the stars. The stars speak of our spiritual nature, whereas the ecliptic, it's local. And it's much more local than what you think. It's the sun is not 93 million miles away. I'll get to that in a minute. After I've established the difference between the two zodiacs, then I will show you the true nature of our geocentric astrological system. It's not heliocentric, it's geocentric. The Earth is the center of all astrology. So Aries, the fiery, and Pisces, the watery, are always there. And instead of it being an argument against astrology, it is one of its grandest truths that in all ages and in all times, Aries, the first sign of the zodiac, has been found ever the same, equally, as well as Pisces, the last. So now he explains what he's going to say, what he's trying to say. In order to convey our meaning, let us digress for a moment and bring forth a fitting illustration. The condition of our atmosphere and the surrounding objects, vegetation, etc., have a peculiar condition and a magnetism wholly their own when surveyed exactly as at sunrise. There is a freshness and a peculiar sense of buoyancy not visible at any other time. If this state could be registered by any instrument and compared with any other set periods during the day, it would offer a remarkable contrast. 2 hours later, there is a very different influence, and at noon, there is a wonderful contrast. The same may be said of sunset and again at midnight. And lastly, note the difference 2 hours before dawn. This is the coolest period of the whole 24 hours. These are facts, and yet our hearts are all beating to the same life flow. And the earth is no farther away from the parent sun, and yet it is the angle at which we, the inhabitants, receive the sunlight, the sun's light, that makes all the difference between dawn and sunset, noon and midnight. When to these facts it is further added that it is sunrise, noon, sunset, and midnight at the same instant, all the time, to some of the various different proportions of the globe. He mentions a globe here. I'm going to show you how we do not live on a globe later. We do not live on a globe. This is the Copernican theory, which was invented in 1543, and the whole world has accepted it, but I'll go into that after.
Mm-hmm.
So, but anyway, he believed that we lived on a globe. So that's fair. I'm going to show how that is impossible. It demonstrates most conclusively that the earth itself is enveloped, so to say, in a complete circle of conditions, very similar to the 12 signs of the celestial zodiac. If we apply the following foregoing illustration to the 12 signs of the zodiac, we shall see a perfect analogy. We shall find that when the sun reaches the celestial equator, so that it is equal day and equal night on the earth, that he is on the line of the celestial horizon, it is a cosmic sunrise. Hence Aries, the fiery Azoth, begins his active influx and extends for 30 degrees, equal to 2 hours of the natural day. So let me explain. Let me just explain what we've just read. What he's saying is that, like I showed last week, this is not just the year, this is the day. 6 a.m., 12 midday, 6 p.m., 12 midnight. Okay? So what he's saying is when the sun rises every day, the angle that the sun is coming into the earth is the brightest and the strongest at sunrise. And so all the birds are chirping and everyone's moving. Everyone's going to work in the morning. As soon as the sun rises, people get up out of bed. Action. Aries. So he says, for 2 hours, as the sun rises every day, it rises its angle. For 2 hours, it will be in the angle of Aries. So no matter which day, whether it's winter or summer, regardless, every day when the sun rises in the east, doesn't matter if it's in November in Scorpio, right now, this morning, when the sun rose in Scorpio, symbolically, it was in the Aries energy for 2 hours, okay? So this is how we explain natural science. We have to adapt astrology to the natural cycles, to the day and to the year. Those two are the best cycles because the day fits perfectly into a year. Morning, afternoon, evening, and night fit into spring, summer, autumn, and winter.
So if someone has, let's say, sun in the ascendant in Scorpio, how would you explain that also being in the energy of Aries? Is it because the ascendant is the head always in the astrological chart, or how would you explain that angle that you're explaining with the sun?
Beautiful. Good question, brother. Excellent. We might as well do that. Insert that right now. Okay. Well, in astrology, there is such a thing called the house system. Let's do the house system. So if we do my equator here, Tropic of Cancer here, Tropic of Capricorn here, and we do this like this, what we have now is we're not going to go up this way. We're going to go down. We have to invert. For astrology, we have to invert this. So the first house is down here. This is the ascendant. This is number one. This is two, three. Four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12. See, now, if the sun is in the 12th house, that is where Aries energy is in the other graphic that I did. So that will be the sun in the 12th house. So if you were born when the sun just came up over the horizon, right, and lingered for 2 hours just above the horizon, climbing, your sun will be in the 12th house, right? Because this is still the daytime and this is still the nighttime. This is the night and this is the day part here. So in the Hindu system, you have this. This is how you do your houses in the Jyotish.
Yep. That's the chart I use.
So the first house is, I have to take this out.
Yeah.
So there's your first, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seven, eight, nine, ten, the midheaven. That's our midheaven.
Okay.
That's your middle of them. 11, 12. Now, sometimes you actually put the first house over here.
Yeah, yeah. I was going to say, like, in Vedic astrology, we use the first house where the midheaven is.
Yes, but this one is also used, and I think this one would be very useful for them to start with the first house here, because then it would correspond exactly with the tropical. Because no matter which system you use, tropical or sidereal, if you have the sun in the 12th house in tropical, you will have the sun in the 12th house in sidereal, because the planets never change. They are always in the same degree in both systems, because they both have to follow this daily ecliptic. This is a daily ecliptic. It starts here and it finishes here. It starts here and it finishes here. Okay. This is a smaller ecliptic. This is the day ecliptic, and these are 2 hours each. So as the zodiac goes around this way and the planets go around clockwise.
Oh, you're talking, okay, now I get it. You're talking about the day ecliptic, not the entirely. Okay, I was a little bit confused. Thanks for correcting that. Okay, now I...
Yes. So this is a daily ecliptic in both systems.
Okay.
So every day the sun rises in the east. This is the east, this is the west.
Yeah.
Okay, this is the east, this is the west, and the same in here, in your sidereal system, okay? I'm trying to do this to help people syncretize the two systems. And by the end of the show, I promise you, the advanced astrologers and the beginners, they will all benefit from this, and they will all learn something, and that's the point.
Yeah.
Okay, I might actually create more confusion by not explaining things thoroughly and properly, but I do need a whole weekend to explain all of this. I know that.
Absolutely.
So I'm already panicking. I'm already anxious and nervous that I'm not going to do a good job.
Oh, no, you will. You always do.
Okay. So what's the first house mean, Kapiel? What does it mean? It means you.
Yeah.
Your personality, your character, your strength,
yeah.
Your physical energy.
Your physical body itself, head.
Yes. Yeah. So that corresponds with Aries, because it's the first sign to rise. See, the rising sign always is number one, because it's the first one to rise when you were born. So if you were born, say, with a Leo ascendant like me, Leo was here rising. My sun was over here at 4:30 p.m. in Aries. Aries was over here in the 8th house, my sun is in Aries, and Leo is rising in the 1st house. So that means at the moment I was born at 4:21 p.m., you look over to the east and you see Leo rising. So that means Leo is my first sign, my ascending rising sign in the east. Therefore, Leo expresses my personality, the lion, the feline, the heart. Leo ascendant always gives people who have their heart, wear their hearts on their sleeves. You know, they speak from their heart. They're courageous. They always encounter troubles in their lives, dangers. They have fame and fortune follow them. That's what the Leo ascendant grants. Okay, so then the second house. What does this field mean? This is your second house?
Home, family, wealth, lineage, yeah. Food, speech.
Good. The third house?
Communication, siblings, skills, hobby.
Good. Same as the third house here?
Yeah.
Fourth house?
Home, mother, happiness, comfort, real estate, vehicles, yeah. Conveniences pretty much.
Exactly. Beautiful. And also the private life. This is the
private
public.
Yeah.
Private, public. Your wealth, your partner's wealth, you and your partner. So you see the opposites always have the opposite meaning. Here is short journeys. Here is long journeys.
Long journeys, yeah.
In the ninth house. Okay. So the meanings are the same. Why? Okay. We know the fifth house is sex, joy, pleasure, children. Mm-hmm. Illness, employees, partners, mates, lawsuits. Here we have inheritances, creativity, death, religion, spirituality, visions, dreams, higher learning, long distance traveling, the career, dignity, honor, glory, distinctions, friends, clubs, associations, enemies, anxieties, fears, hidden things. Okay. They have the exact same meaning. Why? Now, this is what we must understand. Why? Well, the first house has the similarity. It is similar to its meaning as Aries. The second house is Taurus.
Yeah.
Here, the motto of Aries is I am. So this is going to be all about you. This is where you find out information about you in the first house. The motto of Taurus is I have. So what do you have? Well, money, houses, wealth. Here, I think, therefore, this is how you think, how you learn, how you communicate with your brothers and sisters, your neighbors, and your relatives. So you can see Aries coming through here, Taurus, Gemini, Cancer, the home. Cancer is a crab. She loves to hide in her shell, in her home. All right. Leo is the passionate lion. And so this is about pleasure and joy and children because, you know, we have children. Our heart is what determines whether we want to have children. So that's Leo is in heart. Okay. So this is a daily ecliptic. As the sun goes around every day, it takes 24 hours to go around. It rises here. This is midday. It sets here.
That's right. Yep.
And this is midnight. So this is like, this is even though the signs of the zodiac and the planets in them are going this way, clockwise, the houses start here and go that way.
Counterclockwise, yes. Yeah.
Right. Okay. So let's not get confused with these three systems. You've got the, right. We've already spoken about the sidereal tropical, the sidereal zodiac. We've spoken about the tropical zodiac. And now this is the house system, which is
house system exactly
going around this way. So let me clarify. I forgot to explain this. You asked the question: if someone is born before the sun rises, it will be in the first house because right. Here the sun has not risen yet. So if you have the sun in the first house, you're going to have a solar personality. You are going to be very brilliant in your personality. The sun will come through in your character and people will see you because this is the first house of influence in your chart. This is the first field. But if the sun rises and it's already above the horizon, well, it's in the 12th house. Here it is in mid-morning. Here it's closer to mid-afternoon, so midday. So this is a very unlucky house, very unlucky. So it's wise not to birth your children between 6 a.m. and 8 a.m. Best time would be for the sun to be in these three houses here. The best time to have your children to be born would be between, say, this is 8 10 a.m. and this is 12 midday, around roughly, depends because in different latitudes, this moves a little bit, okay? It's not exact.
So why is that it's not good, it being born on the ascendant?
Well, after the ascendant. It's good in the ascendant. It's very good here. Why? Well, because these houses are angular.
Yes, yeah.
You know already that the first house, the seventh house, the 10th house,
yeah,
and the fourth house, you know that they are the strongest.
Yeah.
Why? Well, because they are on the angles which are morning, midday, sunset, and midnight.
Mm-hmm.
These are angular. So whatever planets are in there, they have most of the strength in these angular. But these houses, these are cadent. They're the weakest. The cadent houses which are 12 and 6. They are the weakest houses. You know that?
Yeah.
There's a lot of bad luck in those houses, is there not?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, or a lot of misfortune, illnesses, enemies. And even the 9th and the 3rd, which are, they're weak, but they're good houses. They're much better. You want planets in these ones more so than in these ones. Here, they will suffer. But in the middle, these ones here, these middle ones, they're called succedent. So you've got angular, succedent, and cadent. The angular ones are the strongest. They have 50% of the strength. The succedent ones are about 35% strong. And the cadent houses, they are 15%. They are very weak. Okay? And it's the same as cardinal, fixed, mutable. The cardinal signs, they are the strongest. They have 50% of the strength. The fixed signs, about 35% of the strength. And the mutable signs, they have about 50% of the strength because they are mutating. Mm-hmm. They are weaker. So in the sign system, it's the same as the house system. Yeah, so these angular, so if you have the sun in the ascendant rising, this is very, very strong. This is very good. Here, you've lost a lot of the sun's good energy. It's still, you will still have benefits. Here, you will have mystical experiences. You will have other things to learn that are more hard for you. Here, there are lawsuits and imprisonment and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of meanings here, anxieties, fears, hidden enemies. So it's probably better to have your children born in the 11th house where they will have many friends. This is the house of friends.
Yeah.
Clubs and organizations and groups and associations. So it's better for them to be born between 8 a.m. and 10 a.m. My son has his son in the 11th house. He was born at 8:30. So he has this, he's got a lot of friends, my son. He's Libran, and he's got so many friends. He's 24 years old. He's a musician, and he's got a lot of stuff in his 11th house. So he's very, very friendly and got a lot of friends. But someone who has their son here in the 10th house, these people, wow, Sri Rama has a son in the 10th house, and he's Aryan because he's the Lamb of God. Mm-hmm. Krishna is Sri Rama. It's the same.
Yeah.
So born on the 15th of April, and so that's every year you have what's it called? Ramanavami? The birthday.
Ramanavami, yeah.
Yeah, the birthday of Sri Ram. Well, that's the ram or the lamb, and that's when we celebrate Easter, around about the 15th of April. So it's the same thing. It's because the sun is in Aries. And so Sri Ram, he has the sun in Aries where it exalts, and in the 10th house, that's the greatest success in the public life. This is the house of Godship. Always astrologers look for the first house and the 10th house. These are the two lucky ones. These are the ones that tell you more about the individual than any other sign house. Okay? But it's very important to remember, both in sidereal and in tropical, if you're born, say, at 5 a.m. in the morning, you will have in tropical, you'll have the sun here, and in sidereal, you will have the sun also in the first house. It will never change. This never changes through both systems. The only thing that changes is one thing. The constellations will be out of sync. That's right. All that will change. That's the only thing that changes. In sidereal, the constellations at the moment are lagging behind the tropical, which is fixed. It's not saying that one is wrong and one is right. It's just explaining to people how they both work and how they both interact with each other and both have meaning and importance in our lives. And
so if let's say somebody had sun in Scorpio in Western or tropical and sun in Libra in sidereal, and they came to you, Santos, Somebody told me I have sun in Scorpio. Someone's telling me sun in Libra. How can you explain this to me? What would Beautiful. You tell them?
All right. Well, firstly, I would do this. I would say to that individual, if I was going to do tropical.
Yeah.
First house, second house, third, fourth. So you've got AC over here, DC over here, and MC over here. By the way, that spells Adam, A-D-M. Let me just show you something here, because I've said this many times in my presentations, and I always suspect, because my intelligence tells me that there will always be people who don't always take your word for truth. And yeah. That's good. And that's a good thing. We should never totally and wholly believe anyone. But when we get familiar with their message and we know that it comes from source and good grounding, then we can grow our trust, but we should always double check and confirm everything for ourselves. So when I say to people that the ecliptic is Adam, you see the man inside the zodiac, the ecliptic is in my body. I showed you that before. And I say that is Adam. Well, people think, well, where did you make that up? You know, you're making things up. Well, here's a philosopher from 2,000 years ago called Zosimos, a Greek philosopher. I just want to read this quickly. Mm-hmm. And then we'll go back to that Libra Scorpio. Okay. Scorpio. Have a look at this. He says in his book called On the Letter Omega. So he's talking about the Greek letter O, Omega. And in there, I found this gem. He says, so when the first man among us is named Toth, and among them, Adam, a name from the language of the angels. And not only that, but with respect to the body, the name they refer to him by is symbolic, composed of four elements. So what he's saying is the name Adam is symbolic. It's composed of four elements, fire, earth, air, and water. And he says, from the whole sphere, for the letter A of his name signifies the ascendant, east, and air, and the letter D of his name signifies the descendant, west, and earth, which sinks down because of its weight, and the letter M of his name signifies the meridian, south, and the ripening fire in the midst of these bodies, the fire belonging to the middle, fourth planetary zone. What did he just say there? Well, he just said what I just said, that the ecliptic is Adam, and astrology is Adam. And energy is Adam or atom, atomic. Adam and atom are the same word. And the Egyptians said, all is atom. Ascendant, descendant, meridian. Oops. That's Adam. So what I do, it's very easy to do the reading in both systems. So in tropical, let's say your sun is in the 11th house, okay? So the sun will be in the 11th house in both systems. In sidereal, he's a Libran. In tropical, he is a Scorpio. So in the tropical system, here in this house will be Scorpio. Scorpio might be just here on the cusp here. Yeah. So there's Scorpio, okay? So we should put the sun in there. Let's put the sun here in Scorpio in the 11th house. So there's Scorpio in between the 10th house and the 11th house, but the sun is in the 11th. And so he's a Scorpio. So what I'm saying, what I would say is, well, you mix the sun in the 11th house with the element of water and the nature of Scorpio, which is martial, aggressive, and intensely emotional. Let's keep it simple. If Libra is there, in the sidereal system. Now, this guy's Libran. He's not a Scorpio. His sun's in Libra. Libra is here in the 11th house. Well, then you have to join the 11th house meaning, which is friends. It's the house of friends and good luck and charm, clubs, associations, organizations, with the element of air and the ruler, Venus, of Libra. So this is entirely different now. So
right.
the way this sidereal Libran guy treats his friends is slightly different to how the Scorpio guy is going to treat his friends. In the tropical system, he will be bringing Scorpio energies to his friendships. In the Libran system, he will be bringing loving, virtuous, Venetian principles and air intellect to his friends. Mm-hmm. So he's going to communicate with his friends on an intellectual level. Whereas in the tropical system, he will be communicating through the emotions of Scorpio, deep and powerful and very martial and aggressive. But the way I see it is that both can be correct and are correct, because one, to me, the sidereal system is speaking of the stars. It is transcendent. And there are many bodies inside of us. There's the causal, celestial, the template, the etheric, the mental, the emotional, and the physical body. These are eight bodies. And so sidereal, I believe, is more attuned to the astral, to the celestial and the causal bodies of the individual. Whereas I see tropical as penetrating deeper in the body of the human being, the emotions and the mental and astral nature of the human beings. So you can actually do two readings. And I've had sidereal, I've got many Jyotish astrologer friends, and they've done my Piscean. See, I was born on the 24th of March, so in sidereal, I'm a Piscean. But in tropical, I am Aryan. Now, I can see both of those coming through me. When and only when I contemplate and meditate and understand the elements and the natures of the signs. So basically, the discrepancy between sidereal and tropical is only the constellations. It's not the planets. The planets are the same. They will always be in the same place in both systems. So let's have a go at the sidereal. Sorry. I made a mistake there. I got a little visitor friend.
Oh.
He wants some seeds, but I'm not going to give him any because
oh,
they're...
look at that. Wow, he came inside.
Hey, little fella.
Wow, you are completely in tune with nature.
Oh, yeah, brother. Come on. Here we go. He's a bit shy.
He's camera shy.
He wants me to put the seeds down.
Uh-huh.
Because he knows that if I pick him up, I like to play with him, and he doesn't want to be disturbed when he's eating. So he's very small.
Okay. Is he your own, or he just always comes from outside?
Oh, mate, I've got hundreds. If I feed them,
yeah,
I will have. This is called a king parrot. This is a male. He has a red head and a green body. The females have green heads and red bodies.
Yeah, that is so true. Wow, that's a beautiful bird. Oh man, that's awesome.
And they're cheeky. They come into the house, so I've got to keep things shut. I've got to always watch them because they're very cheeky.
Wow.
All right, a little bit of a detour there for nature's sake.
Absolutely.
Now, so let's do some sidereal.
Okay.
So this is the AC, the first house, second, third, fourth, fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth, ninth, 10, 11, 12. Here is your MC. Now, most astrologers, they just want to see, the first thing they look at is the ascendant and the MC. Those are, the first house is the strongest house. The 10th house is the second strongest house, okay? And so this is the more or less the private life. Aries, it has to do with Aries, the sheep. And Capricorn is the 10th sign. And so it's the sheep and the goat in the houses. So, and this is a motif which is in every sacred theology, the sheep and the goats. So what we have here, if the sun is rising in the first house and you are in sidereal, you will be a Libran. So that's Libra's rising and you have the sun in Libra, because it's in the first house and it's in Libra. So you have to add the sun's element, hot and dry, to Libra's element of air. So the sun is fire, hot and dry. Libra is dry and hot and moist, isn't it? Is air hot and moist?
Kapha. It has that kapha element of Ayurveda. I'm not sure exactly what it is. It's a moisty element.
Fire is hot and dry. Air is hot and moist, I think. Water is cold and wet. And earth is cold and dry. Yes, so air is hot and moist. Okay. Those are the four humours. Two active humours, hot and cold, and two passive humours, dry and moist. Sometimes they are called agents and patients. So what you would do then is you would say the sun is here. So this guy has a very intellectual personality because he's Libran. Libra is the intellect. It's the air element. It's the mind. It's intellect. If he had Aries here, that would be different. It would be fire. So he would have an intuitive nature, more intuitive than intellectual. But if we make this tropical now, this person will have Scorpio rising.
Yeah.
And also the sun will be rising, because the sun will always be in exactly the same place, always, forever, in both systems. It never changes. In the houses, they are always exactly in the same place, because this is a daily ecliptic. You can't move it. You can't shift it. If the sun hasn't risen yet, well, it hasn't risen yet in both systems.
That's right.
So it'll be in the first house. If the sun's rising, here is from six. This is the 12th house. So this is from 6 to 8 a.m. in the morning. And so it will be the same in tropical. You cannot change this.
Right.
So now the individual has a Scorpio personality, because the ascendant sign really deals with your character and personality in this one lifetime and how you act in your body. It's more of the body's personality. It's not the spirit personality, which is your sun sign.
Mm-hmm.
Sun sign really shows you your true spiritual personality, whereas the ascendant gives you your body's personality. Okay? So that's how I would explain that. I hope I did a good job, brother.
Absolutely. Be a brilliant job.
But I do want to continue this, because this is going to produce many aha moments for all the listeners. Okay. So be patient and I'll get through that. So the earth is enveloped, so to say, in a complete circle of conditions, very similar to the 12 signs of the celestial zodiac. If we apply the foregoing illustration to the 12 signs of the zodiac, we shall see a perfect analogy. We shall find that when the sun reaches the celestial equator, so that it is equal day and equal night on the earth, that he is on the line of the celestial horizon, it is cosmic sunrise. Hence Aries, the fiery Azoth, begins his active influx and extends for 30 degrees, equal to 2 hours of the natural day. It is the fiery red streams of awakening life that we all manifest at sunrise. Then comes a change of magnetic polarity after the first fiery flush of cosmic life, the gleeful chattering of the birds and the cackling of the poultry. A reaction is noted. All things before active become restful and quiet. So between 8 and 10 in the Taurus part of the mid-morning, Taurus is always in the mid-morning, It's calmer. This corresponds with the sign of Taurus. It is the solar influx 30 degrees removed from this point of equilibrium toward the north. As this sign represents the powers of absorption, we see that at this period, vegetable and animal life is quietly absorbing for its own use the fiery streams of solar life. Again, we view the activity of solar influx from a different angle and change of polarity, and all things become active in its executive force. This corresponds to the sign of Gemini. It is the solar influx 60 degrees removed from his point of equilibrium. Then comes another change of magnetic polarity. It is rest from labor. It is noon. This corresponds to Cancer. So he's going through, what he's doing is he's going through all the segments. So if we do the tropical circle, and we have the 12th house here. What he's saying is that during the day, not during the house system, which has Aries here, Taurus here, and Gemini here, he's saying that Aries is here during the day because it's the first 2 hours of sunrise. And then Taurus is here between 8 and 10 in the morning. Here's 12 midday, and Cancer starts over here. So now he's talking about Cancer, and he's saying, the solar influx, 90 degrees removed from his point of equilibrium toward the north and his highest point in the arc of his apparent journey and of cosmic life, it is in the equilibrium of life forces. Again, the fiery influx begins its activity, and the hottest part of the day is about 2 hours after noon or the middle of the day, and this corresponds to Leo. So he's showing how Leo here, and then the sun is hottest between 2 and 4 every day. And so what he's saying is that what determines the influence of the tropical zodiac is the angle of sunlight as it climbs every day. Every 4 minutes, the sun goes into a different degree. Every 4 minutes, the sun travels 1 degree on the ecliptic.
Mm-hmm.
Every 4 minutes, the magnetic condition being beamed down from the sun is changing. This is what controls tropical astrology, the ecliptic. So this is what he's saying. We are controlled by a more local ecliptic. There are many ecliptics, as we're going to see in a minute. But this tropical ecliptic is the path of the sun. And on that ecliptic, on that line, every sign has 30 degrees. And so what he's saying is that when the sun enters Gemini, it is 60 degrees removed from equilibrium. This is the point of equilibrium. This is the point that determines the sun's rays and the sun's influence. When the sun is here on the 21st of March, the energy from the sun is balanced. And so all of humanity, all of nature will receive a balanced frequency of energy coming from the sun, perfectly balanced, perfectly poised on the equinox. Then on the 22nd of March, the sun has progressed 1 degree on the ecliptic. It is beaming down a new angle of energy. Everything is changed. From day to day, everything changes. Everything does. And the magnetic influences that affect the flowers, the humans, everything, the weather, everything is changed by the degree of the sun on the ecliptic. So this is important. I'm trying to stress here to people who have shunned tropical astrology for so many years, because because it differs with the beautiful starry constellation. So when they get their smartphones, you know, they get their smartphones and they go, a lot of people write to me and they say, oh, Santos, the sun's not in Scorpio, it's in Libra. I just checked my smartphone and I just checked the computer. Yeah, well, that's because you're in an astronomical application. You're not doing an astrology. You're not going into a tropical astrology, because the tropical astrology will tell you where the planet is on the ecliptic as compared to the 21st of March, the equinox. So it always has this point where it starts, the equinox, the equator. And so when the sun travels one day, 1 degree, it will always be in that sign in respect to the ecliptic, not in respect to the stars who are slipping behind the ecliptic. And so this is where many people lose heart and they think, oh, well, what am I? Am I a Scorpio or am I a Libra? And I went to my smartphone and it says the sun's, I can see clearly that the sun is in Libra. Well, yeah, astronomically, sidereally, it is. It's factually, actually in Libra. But tropically, it's not, because the angle that is beaming down from the sun, from the ecliptic, is the angle which belongs to the segment of whatever, Scorpio in this case, okay? All right, I think I'm satisfied with the way I'm explaining this so far. Yeah. I'll try to, there's 5 more minutes, I'll tidy it up and make it really nice. And then I'll show you exactly how we live on a horizontal plane, Earth. It's not a globe, and astrology can only work on a horizontal plane Earth, which Srimad Bhagavatam, the Bible, the Quran, all the books agree that we live on a horizontal plane and the globe is an invention of man. And I'll teach you, I will show you, I've got a list here of all the Jesuits who brought us the globe and the lie of the globe. I will name all the individuals that need to be blamed for the lie of globalism and the globe. But let me complete and finish this to explain the influences of the sun and its rays as it beams down from the ecliptic, its various angles. Angles are angels, by the way. In the Hindu cosmology, angels are gods. So when you have 330 million gods, they're angels, archangels, seraphim, cherubims, orphanims. They are principalities, archetypes, archons. But see, in the Hindu system, it's much more simple. They tell you, honestly, that Vishnu is a god, Brahma is a god, Shiva is a god, but there is only one God. They know that. Everything goes back to the one Godhead, but there are many gods because nature has many gods, many angles, many angels. And those angels penetrate through our atmosphere, through the ecliptic and the starry heavens beyond the ecliptic. So let's continue on. So he goes through this and what he establishes in here, if you read the first chapter of this book, is he establishes that when the sun is displaced from that point of equilibrium, which is March the 21st, the equinox, every angle preceding, following or succeeding that is the angle of influence that determines the astrological influences. You see? So the tropical system is 100% accurate. It's not inaccurate. And medically, it's infallible. And I've done thousands of medical charts. I do a lot of medical astrology. And the degree of the planet in, say, Libra, which is affecting the kidneys, because Libra is the kidneys, you can rest assured that these people will have trouble with their kidneys depending on the planet that is there. If it's Jupiter, it's hot and moist, so you need to have Chinese herbs that will cool down the liver, or the kidneys. If it's, say, Saturn is cold and dry, so they need to put moisture. They have to take medicine or herbs that will put moisture in their kidneys, in their Libra, which is struggling, okay? Mm-hmm. So medical astrology works like this on the four humors: hot, cold, dry, moist. So at each sunrise, as each sunrise is different in its aspects, So are no two signs of the zodiac alike. The sunrise on the 1st of March is wholly different from the sunrise upon the 1st of May. So is the beginning and ending of each sign. The beginning and ending of the natural day, peculiar unto itself. When we reflect upon the inner laws of this action and interaction, we come nearer and nearer to the one great occult fact, vis-a-vis the divine oneness of life. The divine oneness of life. We find a perfect analogy between the destiny of life and expression of life on the earth, and the life and the material destiny of embodied man. He too has his sunrise, the beginning of a new day of life, the seed time, the flowering season, when life wears a roseate hue, the ripening fruits of experience. His harvest time, it may be tares of or golden grain, his gradual decay, the ebbing of life forces, the icy winter of death. You see, so he's saying we also have our ecliptic. When we're born, we're babies, that's the springtime of our life. When we're adolescents, it's the summer. When we start getting old, it's autumn. I'm now in the autumn of my life because I've gone past, I'm 53 years old, so I've declined past that youthful, expanding, growing. Now it's, and then soon there will be the winter and the icy winter of old age. You see, so there is an ecliptic in your life. There is an ecliptic in your breath, in your day, everything. Everything starts in Aries and finishes in Pisces. That's nature. That's how you model a Taurus field. There's only one way to model a Taurus field, and that is astrologically. Okay, so I'm just about finished. Floods and tempests, periods of drought and plenty. Within this triune constitution, there are spring tides and low tides of physical, intellectual, and spiritual forces. Man also makes the annual journey about the solar center, when at the beginning of each new year, to him, the life forces of his soul are renewed, regalvanized, so to say, according to the magnetic polarity of his constitution. And so, every form of life has its zodiac, its orbit of life and destiny. It may be infinitesimal or vast beyond conception. Each in its own peculiar plane. So we see that the whole visible universe is one vast organism, the medium of expression for the invisible, real universe, the soul and God, the great central sun, the eternal center of all life, binding the whole into unity, one life. The celestial signs of the shining zodiac have no existence on us apart from the graceful and unwearying motion of our Mother Earth. She alone, well, I'm going to show you that the Earth does not move, so he's wrong here. I'm going to prove that the Earth is stationary and immovable. She alone makes our seasons, years, and destiny, and she alone, by her motion about the sun, determines the thrones and mansions of the planetary powers. What he should be saying is it's the sun. It's the sun alone that makes, it's the sun interacting with the earth that makes all the season. The astrological zodiac of Saturn. Anyway, that's enough. I've explained all that. And then the other thing I want to show you is the true nature of our geocentric astrology. This is Ptolemy. Ptolemy lived about 2,000 years ago. This is the most famous astrologer in the history of the universe, astrologer. When it comes to astrology, Ptolemy is number one. And this is his book, Tetrabiblios, the three books. That's what it means. And here in the introduction, it explains the nature of our cosmos. Last week, you asked me the question about the nine planets and how they work. And so let's do that and we'll finish with that.
Okay.
So this is how our cosmos really exists. See, when Copernicus came along, Copernicus was the guy who introduced the hypothesis, the theory of the globe. And it's never been updated from a theory. It's never been a fact that we live on a globe. Despite the CGI images of NASA of a globe and the blue marble that the Japanese have given us, these are CGI images. They are false, and they're not photographs. They are images because they cannot photograph the whole of the planet Earth because it is a horizontally extended plane which extends way beyond the Arctic South Pole. The Arctic Circle is a circle around our flat circle Earth, and the Sun does circles every day above the Earth as it goes around in the heavens. Let me explain how this works.
Mm-hmm.
So our Earth is a flat horizontal plane, according to the book of Revelation 20, verse 11, where it says the Earth is a platos. That's the Greek word, platos or platus, which means a flat plane. Okay? Revelation 20, verse 11, or verse 9, I think it is. So here's the Earth from above. There's the North Pole. This is the South Pole, the Arctic Ring. And beyond there, there are many, many lands. One famous Australian explorer called Sir Captain Hubert George Wilkins, he was a friend of Admiral Byrd, who went into the Arctic Circle, and he found many lands in the Arctic Circle, beautiful in the north. Here there's life. Here there is no life. But beyond here, Sir Captain George Hubert Wilkins, he went 5,000 miles beyond the South Pole, and he discovered many unknown lands to humanity, okay? So I'll show you a map of that if you want to see it, I can share screen. Is it possible to share screen?
It's not going to be available on your side.
No?
If you see a share screen, you can, but I don't have a paid version of the Zoom, the full version that lets you do that.
Oh, okay. All right.
Yeah, so I don't see it on mine either right now.
Okay, mm-hmm. Don't worry. That's fine. Well, see, what this is the Tropic of Cancer, this is the equator, and this is the Tropic of Capricorn. And so in June, the Sun is here. Mm-hmm. Okay, in September, it's here. And in December, it's going to be here. And Australia is around here. So Europe is over here. And India, near the Tropic of Cancer, very hot in India, because India is very, very close. This is called Jambudweep, the island of Jambudweep, in the fifth canto of Srimad Bhagavatam. It says the earth is a circle, and it's sitting on top of Bhumandala. Bhumandala. Bhu means the world.
Yeah.
Everyone in India who speaks Hindi and all the languages, they know that means Bhumandala. And mandala, well, that's a circle. Okay? So what happens is there is another phenomena called the analemma. Do you know the analemma? That's the analemma.
Okay.
Yeah. The analemma is the path of the sun. That's the ecliptic. So if you go to Google Images and you put the word analemma, you'll see the ecliptic and how it works over a flat earth. And this is the sun. This is the sun. Here is the equinox, Aries, Taurus, Gemini is here. Here is Cancer, Leo, Virgo stops here. Libra is here, Scorpio, Sagittarius, Capricorn at the Tropic of Capricorn. Aquarius, Pisces, Aries. The 15th of April, when Sri Rama is born, is here, right in the middle of the figure eight. The figure eight, it does not cross over on the equator. It crosses over at the eighth degree of latitude above the equator. Interesting that the figure eight of the analemma crosses here, 8 degrees, and it's the figure eight. And that day there, on the way going up, when the sun's going up to the Tropic of Cancer, and it crosses there, that's the 15th of April. That's the birthday of Sri Rama in Aries. Because Aries stops here. Starts here at the equator, stops here. That's the birthday of Sri Rama. On the way down, it's the 29th of August. You might want to find out what that means in the Sanskrit Hindu calendar, but in the West, in our Christian calendar, the 29th of August is the day of the beheading of Saint John the Baptist. He gets his head cut off. Well, that's the head there. How do I know? Well, it's easy. John the Baptist, his birthday is here on the 24th of June.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus, the Lamb of God, has his birthday over here in Capricorn on the 25th of December. You see, John the Baptist, his cousin, is 6 months older. And so when John the Baptist says he will go on increasing and I will go on decreasing, well, it's simple. It's the sun. The sun increases from here, from Capricorn, it climbs. It's waxing. And then when it gets to John the Baptist's birthday, it has to wane. It has to decrease. So John the Baptist, this famous biblical archetype character, because none of them are literal. They're not literal at all. It's all allegoric and anagogic, metaphorical, and symbolical.
Even Jesus.
Yeah, even Jesus. For sure, man. For sure. Jesus.
But I know they think like Jesus is the same personification of Amun-Ra, who had his own 12 disciples, had the same way of living his life, was crucified at the age of 30. And so I saw that. I'm like, because it was the Book of the Dead of the Egypt, how the whole story in the Roman Catholic just took the same story and then ran with it. That's what I've heard. So
it's the same story, brother. You'll find if you read when I read Bhagavad Gita, Srimad Bhagavatam, and all of these great books, I see the same cosmology, religion, science as the Christian. They are one and the same. It's if I say to you, I would like an apple in English, and then if I say it in Italian, vorrei una mela, and then in Spanish, quisiera una manzana, I've just said the same thing in three languages.
Three languages, yeah.
It's the same thing. The result is I get an apple. And the same is with all the theologies. When Jesus has 12 disciples, it's the sun with the 12 signs of the zodiac. Jacob, which is the sun, has 12 sons, those are the 12 signs of the zodiac.
No, I loved your description of the Last Supper painting, where all the disciples are somehow showing a zodiac sign. So it completely shows that. Yeah.
Well, it's the Last Supper. And look where Jesus is. He's in the middle of the ecliptic in Libra. You see, if you look here, that's Aries. Aries always starts over here. Aries at the head of the table. He's got his hands on the table. He's the only one that is at the head of the table.
Yeah.
Then you have Taurus. Then you have Gemini. Look at Gemini. What's Gemini
doing? Two hands. Yep.
Yeah, the twins. Okay, then you have Cancer, the crabby Cancer. He's leaning over. He's pointing to the throat of Virgo, saying, hey, there's no Adam's apple here. This is a girl sign of the zodiac. And he has a knife in his hand here because the crab has it's got like little pincers in his hand.
Yeah.
Leo has his elbow. Look at the elbow of Leo. That's the lion. The lion is the ruler of the zodiac. He's got his elbow on the table. That's rude. That implies, okay, then you have Virgo, the female. Then you have the sun at the middle of the ecliptic. Look at Libra. What's Libra doing?
Balancing.
Yeah. Look at Scorpio. What's...
That back tail.
Yeah, look at the... He's pointing his finger up like his tail. points upward.
Yeah.
Oh, you always see that tail pointing upward. Look at big Jupiterian Sagittarius, the horse, very big. Look at the black Capricorn, Saturn rules Capricorn. Look at the dark or the wise old
man,
Aquarius. Look at Pisces with his two hands, the two fish.
Two fishes. Wow, this is crazy.
So what you're seeing is the Last Supper. Why is it the Last Supper? Well, because the sun has to die. That's where the sun is, on the 23rd of September. What's the 23rd of September called in Jewish? Judgment Day. Every year, where the sun, on his Last Supper, because tomorrow he will die, right next to Libra, is because the sun dies here because it has to go down to hell.
Yeah.
Down to winter. Hell is inferno. Winter is inverno. So when you go to hell, you don't go to a hot place. It's a cold place. It's winter. So the sun, that's the Last Supper. That's Judgment Day. In Libra, the scales of judgment, that's where the sun sets. That's the symbol of Libra, yeah?
Yeah.
That's the sun setting. Even Omega in Greek, that's the sun setting. Omega means big O. Who's big O? The sun. Remember we said the sun was solo, sol invictus, and the moon is mono?
Yeah.
That's Latin for alone. That's Greek for alone. And then you take that O off and you've got Solomon, the temple of Solomon, the temple of the sun and the moon. It's the ecliptic. This is the temple. And so when Jesus dies at the Last Supper, he's been living here with his disciples. He's had a great time.
Yeah.
And then he has to have the Last Supper. And what do they eat at the Last Supper? The bread and the wine. Well, Virgo is the wine season. Libra, Virgo is the bread season. You harvest your grains here in August, September. September is the wine season. And so here's what's on the table, the bread and the wine.
Exactly.
And the sun is in the middle saying, tomorrow I'll be dead. Please remember me.
Yeah, wow.
The Last Supper. There's nothing literal in the Bible. There is nothing factual in the Bible. There's only truth in the Bible. And it's spiritual truth, which churchgoers who unfortunately are deluded swine eaters, they will never understand. They will never understand this because they're eating dogs and animals and corpses. When you eat corpses, your mind is putrefied. The only way to ascend the mind is to eat vegetarian. And India is the leading example of vegetarian food on the planet. India was totally vegetarian before the English and the Muslims came along. And they always didn't eat cows and pigs and all that rotten stuff.
Well, what I want to ask you is regarding the flat earth thing, what is the bottom of this looks like? What is at the bottom?
Underneath,
what is the shape at the bottom? I mean,
okay, well, there are some people talk about hollow earth because they've actually been through the portal at the North Pole and they've been under the earth and they believe that it's the earth is hollow, but it's not. It's not hollow. Here is the earth. Mm-hmm. Above us we have a dome like this. It's called the firmament, and that's where the stars are, the fixed stars. And then under that you have Saturn's ring, sphere, Jupiter, Mars, the sun, Venus, Mercury, and the moon. So there are seven principalities or kingdoms or realms. And underneath you have seven planets too, underneath the earth, and they are flat. And they are the hellish planets. In Bhagavad Gita, it calls these the heavenly planets. But Putala at the bottom, that is a hellish planet. And Atala at the top, supposedly, there are people, they live here, and they come through the North Pole, and these people are controlling our planet. And this is what they call extraterrestrials, you know, Anunnaki, reptilians, and greys, and all of these under the Earth. There are seven planets under our planet Earth. And above us, there are 10 layers. I'll show you the 10 layers. We live inside a concentric cell, if you like. So here's the Earth. There's seven below us. And we have a dome here. And we have seven levels below that. And the ecliptic is what these seven planets travel on. And the zodiac, which is the sidereal zodiac, is in the firmament. This is called a firmament. These are the fixed
How
stars.
How high is this firmament?
It's probably only about 5,000 miles high.
But the aeroplane goes all the way up to 20,000, 25,000 miles high, 15,000?
No, only 25 miles. Not 1,000. They go 30,000.
Oh, wait, that's feet. Okay, I'm sorry. Yeah.
Yeah, which is very low, which is about down here. But all the rockets that they shoot, them up like that, and then they go like this and fall into the ocean. No rocket has ever passed this glass ceiling. This is a glass toroidal ceiling. This is protecting us. Okay? Now.
Protecting us or guarding us?
Yeah, there are many of these universes. This is one universe. There's millions of these universes. Okay, let me show you how the Hare Krishnas. This is from the Hare Krishnas.
Yeah.
They have the earth here in the middle. This is from Srimad Bhagavatam.
Yeah.
And here are the seven. Here are the seven hellish planets below. And these are the seven planets above us, Saturn, Jupiter, the sun. And so the rishis, they go to the moon, yeah, when they leave here. So they can either go to the heavenly planets or they can go and live with Krishna in Vrindavan. This is Vrindavan. This is Vaikuntha. This is Brahmajyoti, the white light. This is where the Buddhists say they're going to go to the white light. Okay, here's Vishnu. This is Krishna and Radharani. Here is Vishnu and Lakshmi. Here is Shiva and Shakti. This is the Shiva kingdom down the bottom here, Shiva. And here is Brahma, Brahma's world. This is Brahma's universe, which he makes from his, from his umbilical cord.
Mm-hmm.
And he dreams up these lotus worlds. And the lotus worlds are Taurus fields. That's all it is. The lotuses are Tauruses. And so people who ascend, they ascend into these heavenly planets. They go to Jupiter or Saturn or the sun or the moon. And if they go back to cause, they go straight back to Vrindavan, back to Krishna, to be with God and to be as God. So here is told me when 500 years ago, when Copernicus came along, mm-hmm. they said the Ptolemy's geocentric model was debunked. And now we know that we live in a heliocentric system. Well, let me show you the true model that I just showed you now. And I'll read it. It'll only take me a few minutes and we'll be finished soon.
Sure.
Okay? Because I know you like to do shorter vids. The world is divided into two parts, the elemental region and the ethereal. The elemental region is constantly subject to alteration and comprises the four elements, earth, water, air, and fire. The ethereal region, which philosophers call the fifth essence, the quintessence, encompasses by its concavity,
mm-hmm.
the elemental. Its substance remains always unvaried, never changes, and consists of 10 spheres, So I'm gonna show you now the 10 spheres. I just showed you 8, the firmament and the 7 planets below, but there's 2 more above, okay? And here is where you'll learn about it. This is 2,000 years of wisdom, Western wisdom. So it consists of 10 spheres, of which the greater one always spherically environs the next smaller, and so on in consecutive order. So he's saying it's like a Russian doll. The first one, the 10th, will encompass the one, the next one concavely underneath it. So we have 10 concave heavens, principalities above our heads. Okay, when we look at Venus, we're not looking at a terrestrial body. It's a gaseous body, and it's a realm, it's a principality, it's a spiritual kingdom full of beings, living beings. First, therefore, around the sphere of fire, God, the creator of the world, placed the sphere of the moon, then that of Mercury, then that of Venus, then that of the sun, and afterwards those of Mars, of Jupiter, and of Saturn. Each of these spheres, however, contains but one star. So in other words, he's saying Jupiter is a star.
Mm-hmm.
Not planets, they're stars, wandering stars, as opposed to fixed stars. And these stars, in passing through the zodiac, always struggle against the primum mobile. The primum mobile is the 10th sphere. Or the motion of the 10th sphere. They are also entirely luminous. So he's saying that the stars are just luminous. In the next place follows the firmament, which is the 8th or starry sphere, and which trembles or vibrates in 2 small circles at the beginning of Aries and Libra. This motion is called by astronomers the motion of the axis and recess of the fixed stars, probably in order to account for precession of the equinoxes. Well, we just did an hour of precession and explain how the stars move against the tropical ecliptic, mm-hmm. hence they precess. So he's saying that these 2 trembling motions that happen, when you look at my analemma, remember the analemma, well, it's a figure 8. Well, those 2 points at the equinoxes, there's a trembling motion there. There's a vibration that occurs, according to Ptolemy. And that causes precession. And I can explain that, but it'll take a full hour how right. Precession works. Okay, so this motion is called by astronomers the motion of axis and recess of the fixed stars. This is surrounded by the 9th sphere called the crystalline or watery heaven, because no star is discovered in it. Lastly, the primum mobile, styled also the 10th sphere, encompasses all the before mentioned ethereal spheres and is continually turned upon the poles of the world by 1 revolution in 24 hours from the east through the meridian to the west, again coming around to the east. At the same time, it rolls all the inferior spheres around it by its own force, and there is no star in it. Against the primum mobile, the motion of all the other spheres running from west through the meridian to the east, the sun, running from the west through the meridian to the east, contends. Whatever is beyond this is fixed and immovable, and the professors of our orthodox faith affirm it to be the empyrean heaven, which God inhabits with the elect. Okay. So what are we talking about here? Well, he just said that this is how our earth is. There is the first sphere of the moon. This is where the rishis go, and they become the lunar people. Then there is Mercury, and this corresponds to our second chakra. This is the bottom chakra, the moon, red in color, bleeding. Menstrual. Here is Mercury, the orange chakra. Here is Venus, the yellow chakra. Here is the sun, the green chakra. Here is Mars, the blue. Here is Jupiter, the third eye, which is the indigo. And here is violet. And then above this is the eighth sphere. And he said, no star is found in it. Well, he's wrong. It's Uranus. Uranus is in here. Uranus rules the stars and the firmament and all of that body, which is firm and fixed. And those stars never move. There's no parallax in those stars, which indicates that the earth does not move. Otherwise, there would be parallax in the stars. And then beyond that, he says there is a watery, the ninth sphere is a watery sphere. It's called the crystalline sea, made of crystal. That's why it's blue. When you look up in the sky, you see blue. It's because of the water above the firmament. Here is a membrane of water. And then above that is the tenth sphere called the primum mobile. So, primum mobile. Primum means first. It's the first principality. These are principalities. From here, we get all of our life. All of our life comes from here. All of our conditions, all of our virtues, all of our qualities come from here. And when you know how to read a birth chart, and when you know where Jupiter is, you know, if Jupiter is in Leo in the fifth house, and Mars is in Sagittarius in another house, you will know how these planets have influenced you who are standing here on the plane of the earth. And so, did Copernicus debunk the flat earth and the ancient Hindu, Egyptian, Mayan, Grecian, Babylonian, Persian, Arabian cosmos? No, we still live on a flat earth and we still live in this world. And these are the people who have given you the satanic lie of the globe. Here are the names. Pietro Pomponazzi in the 15th century, Jesuit. Gasparo Contarini, Jesuit. He started the Protestant movement. He started the Counter-Reformation. He was the protector of Ignatius Loyola, who started the Jesuits in 1541, and the globe of Copernicus turns up in 1543, 2 years later. He also started the Council of Trent, which was the most evil council of Jesuit demons in history. And his friend was Francesco Giorgi, and these guys funded Copernicus, the Jesuit. Then in the 16th century, we have Paolo Sarpi and Fulgencio Micanzio. They sponsored and funded Galileo Galilei and Newton. No, wait a minute. Newton was funded by the 17th century black nobility Jesuits. Abbot Antonio Conti and Juan Maria Ortez, the Spanish Jesuit, friend of the Spanish aristocracy or oligarchy, they funded Newton and the religion of modern materialism or utilitarianism. And they were the enemies of Godfrey Leibniz, who preached the truth and who was the true inventor of calculus, not Newton. And so all of these guys, Pietro Pomponazzi, Gasparo Contarini, Francesco Giorgi, Paolo Sarpi, Fulgencio Micanzio, Abbot Antonio Conti, and Juan Marcia Ortez, they funded Copernicus, Newton, Galileo Galilei. They were all Jesuits. They were all founded by two families in Italy, the Borgia and the Farnese family. They started the Jesuits in 1541. Then they invented the globe. Then they invented their globalist religion. Now we have a religion, an ideology called globalism, where we have a world global economy, a world governance, new world order.
Mm-hmm.
We have a new world religion, which is Catholicism, and a new world order, which, thank God, thank the heavens, right now, as we speak, is being destroyed. Why? I'll tell you why, and I'll finish with this. Globalism will perish for all eternity. and nationalism the true way to run nations or countries, if you want to call it that. Nationalism is going to smash globalism. And the revival of the flat earth, which is very, very popular on the internet now, we have many scientists, many, 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 many great minds who have joined the flat earth movement, and it will destroy the evil, satanic, demonic, filthy, putrid lie of the globe and its religion of globalism, and it's going to be smashed. And I will be one of the leaders in destroying the globalism religion with all its false Christianity and false churches and teachings and pseudoscience, along with many other intelligent minds who are turning against this satanic, demonic-inspired teaching of the Humpty Dumpty Santa ball, the Humpty Dumpty Santa globe. So
what I wanted to ask you, like, I was kind of questioning that, like, we have a satellite TV, and if the dish is not pointed to a certain direction where they say the satellite is in the air, the TV signal does not come. And I wanted to know, how would you explain that part where, why is it that the satellite only works when it's pointed in the air to a certain, where they're saying their satellite is? Or is there really a satellite?
I don't believe there are satellites as such. I believe they do that, all of that weather, weather forecasting and everything from their little, from the balloons. They actually have these balloons that they fill with gas and they go up. And in fact, that's how they've done all of their photography for Google Earth and all of their weather forecasting. It's these little gas balloons, because you can't get satellites to go past the firmament. There are many glass levels before the firmament. You know, I mean, there is actually glass structures before the sun, you see. So what we're actually seeing is land-based technology. And what they do is they triangulate their signals. And so when you send you face your satellite to a certain direction, mm-hmm. you are actually facing it to where they have set their land-based technology to, to emanate from, because they bounce it off the ionosphere and from the dome. They bounce their waves off of that. And so it's local technology. There are no massive big satellites out in space. You can do some research on YouTube to see that this is all a fraud. And it's a way for the black nobility families to perpetuate the lie of the globe and to perpetuate their false sciences so that they can continue to steal money from the average taxpayer.
Now, you were explaining about the worlds that are below.
Yep.
Like, what is the actual shape, though? Like, where does it end? Like, at the bottom, is it just a globe still? And within the globe, there's all these different worlds? Or is this like some rock at the bottom? I mean, like, because, like, what happens when you reach the edge? How does it go sink in?
Everything is Taurus fields. There's nothing but Taurus fields. There's majestic big ones, yeah. And there's minuscule ones, which we call atoms. Our body is made of atoms, and those atoms are little donuts, little Taurus fields. So the Taurus field, this is the center of a Taurus field, and it goes like this.
Right.
And so you have like an hourglass here in the middle. The earth is here in the middle. It's the middle garden. This is the dielectric inertial plane. This is the center. Here is the dielectric inertial plane. This is terrestrial, and so are the seven planets below us. They are more or less the same width as our earth. Below us, and then above us, you have around this, we have the seven planets. Here is Dhruvaloka, the pole star. Dhruva Loka,
uh-huh.
where Brahma sits, and he has created this world, this cosmos, this universe, and in here. And so what this is, the outside of the Taurus field, in my opinion, this is what we call the firmament. So when we see those fixed stars precessing, they are the actual Taurus field. It's crystalline in structure. It's made of a crystal energy. But this is what is going around us every day. This is moving and turning. It's a big, massive Taurus field. This is the universe, a bubble, a sphere. And inside this sphere, there are, you know, well, in that system we saw from the Hare Krishnas, 15 planets. Middle one here, 7 below, 7 above, and then three layers of firmament, which they call the firmament. Ptolemy calls the firmament, the crystalline sea, and the primum mobile. And so this is where we live. We live in a big apple. Have you heard the expression, this is like an apple of Apollo, a massive Taurus field. And so we live inside the big apple. That's why, hence the expression, the big apple. Everything is apples. And in the center of the apple is the core, the heart, the kur, the kar, diak, the heart. And so welcome to the real world. This is where you live on here. And when the moon turns around the center, this is central tree. This is called Yggdrasil. This is the center, the hyperboloid center of our Earth, the North Pole. Here is the South Pole out here. It's probably around about here. And then when you go further beyond, there are other lands beyond. So this is a massive, massive Taurus field. It's a Taurus field inside of a Taurus field. And everything is Tauruses. There's nothing but Tauruses. Nothing else exists. And so this is what an atom looks like. It looks like this. This is why they say there are shells in an atom. There's first tier shells, then second tier shell. And, you know, like in a carbon atom, they say there's six neutrons, six protons, six electrons, six, six, six. Well, it's all this. That's all they're seeing. When they see electrons, they see planets inside of an atom. And the atom will have an inertial plane. And that's the Earth. That's the middle of the atom. This is atom. All is atom. There's nothing but atom. There's nothing but donuts, toruses, atoms in the universe.
Wow. Oh, man. Well, thank you so much, Santos, for this is like earth-shattering information you gave. So it is. Hopefully, you know, people get to look at it more on an open-mindedness than being closed-minded. So, but hey, I mean, at least people will start questioning, at least.
They will have to
break away from the manipulation that they have taught us from the beginning, but at least people can question and be open to it.
You know? And they will be, because guess what the biggest search on the internet is today?
What
in
is?
The last year. Flat Earth.
Yeah.
Everybody is researching.
I've done it, yeah.
Yeah, even the globetards who insist that we're spinning upside down on a Humpty Dumpty ball, even they spend many hours every day watching the truth but denying it because they have a reputation to keep.
Yeah.
Oh, we can't go against consensus mainstream herd mentality. All the zombies out there believe we live on a Humpty Dumpty globe and we're spinning upside down.
Exactly. Well,
go ahead and make yourself look stupid for the rest of eternity if you want to stick with lies. But it's time to align ourselves to the truth now.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Santos.
And thank you, my friend.
Absolutely. You're welcome.
Take care. Till the next time.
Till next time.